Wouldn't it be wonderful if we could teach the gullible to never be so comfortable with knives they eat like comfort food? To disregard the bogus claims and pseudoscientific claims, can you imagine just how much indeed the world would change? No more political predators playing on the populace with ilkas and plots to shift and kill Metropolis. No more villains with the title in the Bible holding phony temper writings like the stuff they teach is vital. Imagine it was normal to have to prove a claim you made, and folks really feel ashamed expressing content that was fake. It's not to say we never make mistakes, it's just to say we go out of our way to show the evidence it takes.
Remain skeptical while you travel the world or even stay strapped with logic and facts. That's what it is, yo. Keep reality intact. Tell the truth, bro. Question every claim, especially the ones you believe in. Remain skeptical while you travel the world or reason.
Welcome to the award-winning show, Road to Reason, the Skeptic's Guide to the 21st Century. I'm David Tamayo, President of Hispanic American Freethinkers, and today I have the honor, the pleasure, the roller coaster emotional ride that it is to have the Director of Operations for the Richard Dawkins Foundation.
Stephanie Gutormson.
You said your last name wrong.
No, I didn't.
Okay.
That's a different person that we'll have on later.
And today, we're also going to be having the amazing, the genius, the multimedia sexy guy.
David Smalley.
It should be David Biggie. You know,
his name is an indicative of how awesome he is.
And that's one of the things we're going to be talking about today. So today we're going to be discussing atheist media and where that's going and a little bit of history on it maybe. We're going to pick his brain and see how far we can get with that. And then we'll see. Maybe we get to ask some personal questions also and try to embarrass him about his cooking and other problems he's got at home. But we'll leave that for later. So before we get started, we have some announcements. Would you like to start with?
Absolutely. So in a couple weeks, specifically September 18th through the 20th, we are going to, David and I and our guest David Smalley, along with some magicians you might have heard of, Penn and Teller, the amazing Shelley Siegel, who's a really great folk artist.
She's Australian, right?
I do not know where she's
from. New Zealand or Australia? I think it's Australia.
We're also going to see Sarah Moorhead, who's just like the greatest person ever, Teresa McBain, Alex Jones, Victor Harris, Chris Johnson, Sarah Hayter,
and many more.
Ellen Hooper, Matt Dillahunty, love it, JT Eberhard, and myself, and David, as I mentioned. That's going to be in Dallas, Texas. This is a fairly popular conference done by Sarah Moorhead, and what's so great about this conference is that it's fun, it's uplifting, it's not just the dry talks. So there are talks, it's not super dry or anything. It used to be in Lincoln, Nebraska, and Omaha, Nebraska, but now it's in Dallas, Texas, near where Mr. Smalley is, so that's going to be super, super fun. And I think that's all for ApostaCon now.
Anyone in the Dallas area, please come to this event. It's going to be amazing. I've never seen so many people, so many great people in one place, giving so many talks and doing so many stuff. So I understand that Dogma Debate, which is a show that our guest manages and works on, is going to be transmitting directly from there, and that's always an amazing show, the questions and the things that are there. Hopefully we'll even have some protesters, like it happened in Salt Lake about a year and a half ago, and we'll talk about that later. So the other announcement that we have is Reason Rally 2016. Reason Rally 2016 is coming in the spring of 2016, and we're expecting to have about 100,000 people in the mall here in Washington, D.C. So there's enough time right now to start saving your dollars, to start making arrangements, do road trip, whatever, and come with, maybe share a room. The rooms, as far as I know, there are about 5 hotels already the prices have been slashed, so anyone can attend. And we're going to be talking to some of the Unitarian churches and some of the some of the organizations that cater to the nuns. The non-believers and the agnostics and so on, to see if they can come and they can help out providing some transportation and some things. All the hotels are going to be near the train station, so it's a free event. For everyone to attend, and it's going to be amazing. It's really, 100,000 people is the idea, the goal. So I think we can get close to that.
I think so too. Another really great event before we kick off to our next segments is the critical thinking and constructive conversations about faith, and that's a event. Sorry, couldn't think of the word. It's an event by SavedByScience.com, and it's going to be in the Greater Richmond area. I guess on September 13th, yep, run by the Greater Richmond Humanists. Very
And Rob Pensack, another co-host of this show, he is going to be having Peter Boghossian. Dr. Boghossian is going to be connecting via Skype, if you listen to the music at the beginning of our show here, that band is going to be playing there. So
awesome.
It's going to be a really cool time, and again, if you're in the Richmond area or even in the Washington, D.C. area, it's only a couple of hours away, makes for a good road trip.
I mean, we should mention that Dr. Boghossian, besides being an author of Manual for Creating Atheists, mm-hmm. also is working with RDF. In creating the Atheos app that he's going to be releasing very soon.
That
I've
app,
been beta testing it. It's very,
really?
Very fun. Yes.
Oh yes.
Yes.
That's, I've been a couple of other people and I have been helping with the translating it to Spanish.
Oh, fantastic!
So the app is in Spanish. So it's going to be a great thing, and I believe that's almost ready to come out. Also, mm-hmm. that app is about to come out. So the last announcement that I have that I like to bring up is. Hispanic American Freethinkers for the first time this year was able to raise some money to provide a scholarship to a needy student. And the person that won this award is David Hernandez. He's a junior at Brown University in Providence, Rhode Island. And so I think with this show he's finding out that he won this award. He's studying science and with a biology major. And so I'm glad that we can do that, and hopefully we'll be able to do that in the future. So congratulations, David Hernandez. Another David. Seems like Davids are everywhere. So anyway, so why don't we talk about the joke. You have a joke? That perhaps a clean joke, please.
Clean jokes.
I've heard today. I'd better not say anything.
Yeah.
A clean joke.
Clean jokes. So... how come churches don't offer Wi-Fi?
How come churches don't offer Wi-Fi?
Do you know? Do you know why churches don't offer Wi-Fi?
No. Well, why do they?
It's because no church wants to compete with an invisible power that actually works.
That actually works. That's pretty funny. And smart, because, if they did, maybe they have more people attending.
Do religious people use microwaves? For the same reason?
For the same reason. I'm not sure. Or whether the preacher does it or not. We do have a person of the week this week, and that is Dr. Richard Carrier. And the reason, some people have said, I like this person for this and not for that, and so on and so forth. The Dr. Richard Carrier, he's an excellent writer and all of that, but the reason he's the person of the week this year is because he was in Puerto Rico this past week some time ago. He had lost he had been robbed, and they had taken all his things. And some people, he asked for financial help, and people in Puerto Rico helped him, even though the economy in Puerto Rico is not that great nowadays. But he promised that he would go there and support the humanists there and everyone that had helped him there. And he did that this past week. I was there for part of the week, and so I got to see him in action. A lot of free talks, a lot of university debates and that kind of stuff. And the people there were very happy and very grateful that that was the case. So I'd like to say kudos to him, and I hope that I love it when people keep their word. And I hope that that's the case for others, to try to make a difference one way or another. Sometimes we can't repay using money. But, anyway, so we're going to go to a commercial, and they don't call it a commercial, a service announcement. that in a few seconds. But in the meantime, anything else you'd like to add? Any other announcement? You excited about our interview coming up?
I am super excited, but if I can shamelessly plug something.
Please. That's all we do here.
Yes. So I run a channel on the YouTube internets called Think Stuftically, and
good.
You guys should go check that out. I just did a video supporting my friends, The Bible Reloaded, as they had a video taken down by the one and only Ray Comfort. They DMCA'd their video, even though they had no reason to. His ministry, Living Waters, did it. And after some help from some people that are actually going to be at ApostaCon, and the Friendly Atheist Haven't Meta, they were able to get the video put back up. So you should check out that video and all my other videos, like my videos taking down the con artist and charlatan known as Adam Miller. Those are always fun. There's a whole little playlist for you there to go check those out as well. And I think that's where I'm going to leave it for my shameless plugs.
It amazes me how often people, they can't, the best way is to get rid of it so they don't want anyone to compete with the ideas.
Absolutely, it's
free
horrible.
Market, they're afraid.
Yes.
All right, so we'll go to a service announcement and we will be back in a couple of minutes.
Mm-hmm. Homemade noodles. Oh. Marty, stop it. Oh my goodness, I'm so sorry. It reminds me, I've been thinking maybe we should try a new form of birth control. I heard about this one, it's called the IUD, intrauterine device. Or we could try the patch on your arm. Actually, I think that one goes in your butt.
Bedsider.org has birth control information and a lot more. And it's...
What do you think, though? Arm or the butt?
There's a lot of tree branches and dry brush over here. We should probably move the bonfire over there.
I'm guessing Smokey liked that idea.
This is Richard Dawkins. Doing commercials is unfamiliar territory for me, but I'm inviting you to watch Road to Reason, a skeptic's guide to the 21st century, on Fairfax Public Access every Sunday. Each week, the hosts tackle wishful thinking, religion, pseudoscience, and the harm they cause, with a combination of facts, humor, and community involvement. They challenge believers to defend their faith and give you, the skeptic, a voice. With live call-ins for viewers and streaming on the World Wide Web, there's never a dull moment. Don't wait. Look at them now on Facebook and YouTube. And remember to watch Road to Reason, a skeptic's guide to the 21st century, or there'll be hell to pay.
You want to know something really liberating about critical thinking? It allows you to drop all your pretenses. As a critical thinker, there's a recognition that there are no more powerful words in the English language than "I don't know." It's pretty awesome, actually. Admitting you don't know shouldn't be viewed as an admission of weakness or insecurity. It's the only place where real learning and growth begin. Did you ever wonder what it is about being a child that makes life so much fun? What is it that kids have that we lose as we grow up? It's their sense of wonder and delight at discovering things. They know they don't know, and they can't wait to find out. They pester everyone with questions because they want to know everything. Unfortunately, as we get older, that sense of wonder pretty much gets beaten out of us. Socially, we're taught by our peers almost as soon as we start making friends that ignorance is not bliss. The name-calling, the ridicule, and being laughed at soon convince us that it's better to just make things up instead of admitting that we don't know. We get into this habit and pretty soon can even convince ourselves that we're experts in areas we know almost nothing about. We walk around wearing this pretense of knowledge like body armor, but really it's as thin as tissue paper because we know anyone anywhere could find out what a fraud we are at any moment. Do you like living like that? Because I don't. And here's the thing, there's nothing wrong with not knowing. The truth is that saying "I don't know" is not any indication that you're a moron or lacking in any kind of intelligence. It just means you never learned or can't remember something. We are born not knowing, and it's the quest for knowledge and experience that keeps life fresh and keeps us alive. Some of the most miserable, hateful, and spiteful people I've ever known have been the ones who thought they knew exactly what was going on and didn't have anything more to learn. Don't try to tell them anything. They've got it all figured out. Those aren't the people who are changing the world for the better. They aren't even trying. It's those who want to learn, who want to discover, and want to grow. Those are the people upon whom we all depend to make the next big discoveries and take the next leap forward. They are the scientists, the inventors, the philosophers, and the leaders who can take our species to the next level in our evolution. We all have it in us to learn and grow. It starts with an honest appraisal of what we do know, what we are certain of, and being strong enough to admit that we have some more learning to do. I love critical thinking for teaching me this. I can't wait to learn more.
Wow. Welcome back to Road to Reason, the Skeptic's Guide to the 21st Century. But wow.
That was incredible.
That last PSA, I'm telling you, it's really great. But let's not waste any time because we got so much to cover and the clock is running away from us. So our guest today is David Smalley. He's the founder and president of Dogma Debate, which is probably, if not the most popular, one of the most popular podcasts with over 3.7 million downloads and about 23,000, 24,000 subscribers every week. So Dogma Debate deals with all kinds of topics, religion, civil rights, politics. It's really a critical thinking type of podcast that I strongly encourage. David is a former Christian and author of the book Baptized Atheist, and so we'll ask him a little bit about that. And he currently serves as on the National Speakers Bureau for Secular Student Alliance. Students seem to like him a lot, and he's a very sought-after presenter. And he also is the producer of the movie, one of the producers of the movie My Week in Atheism. It's a great documentary. And also he works with audiobooks, atheistaudiobooks.com, and too many things to go through. But why don't you welcome to the show, David.
Welcome, David. How are you doing?
Thank you. I'm doing pretty good. Thanks for having me.
Good. So I think I'm going to start off the questioning pretty simply. Who hurt you to make you the secular powerhouse you are today? Who harmed you?
Point to where you got hurt.
It was right here. They slapped me right there. No, I was not hurt at all. I hear a lot of stories about people who were, you know, abused or mistreated because of religion. I don't really think that was the case. I mean, I had one incident that was uncomfortable, but outside of that, you know, it was mostly just me really, the truth was always really important to me. And I would hear people arguing over things that I knew were facts, like how far away the sun is from the earth. They were fighting about it. I didn't understand that. I'm like, let's look up the answer. There's an answer out there. Why are we pretending to know things we don't know? And then fighting for those things that we don't know. So, you know, my goal, I was a Christian, I was a drummer for a gospel church and a choir, and I started doing door knocking and telling people about Jesus. And I'm like, you know, if I'm going to be telling other people about this, I better know what I'm talking about. So I read the Bible cover to cover, and I got so close to God that I saw that there wasn't one.
Oh my goodness. So you still play the drums?
I do when I can. I mean, it's really cumbersome now, you know, with the studio.
And you still knock on people's doors?
No.
I'm here to tell you nothing. So how old were you when this happened? I mean, how did your family take it? I mean, I'm sure you've told the story 1,000 times, but we have a whole brand new set viewers here.
Well, and that's really why I detailed the story in the book, Baptized Atheist. That's actually the story of me going from Christian to taking you through the questions I asked, the problems I had, the issues I had, the people I talked to. I talked with theology professors and preachers and all sorts of stuff throughout the book because it was my personal journey. I mean, I just wanted to know the truth. And, you know, it started like this. I was getting baptized, and the moment I was baptized, I just thought, why would killing the innocent pardon the guilty? Why did Jesus have to die? I started thinking about these things for the first time right then at that moment. And so as we're standing there for the, you know, the baptizing ceremony, the pastor of the church leans down and he says, you know, son, you can't just say you believe. You have to know it to be true in your heart. And at that moment, I knew that I didn't know anything. I had a belief. I had a hope, but I didn't know anything. And so I started looking into it, and it ended up becoming atheist.
Now, how old were you when this when this happened?
Oh, I'm sorry. Yeah, I guess I should answer the question you actually asked. I've been watching so many politicians
lately. I'm used to being ignored, that's all.
No, I was 15 when I first started questioning, and I think I was about 19 the first time I actually called myself a non-Christian, and I was probably 22 or 23 when I used the word atheist for the first time.
You are 23 or 24 already? You look younger than that. That pact with the devil is working then.
Yeah,
it's
working.
It makes you look that young.
So, David, many people like to claim, or at least people that we know like to claim, that secularism in the United States started with the publishing of The God Delusion, End of Faith, God's Not Great, by authors such as Richard Dawkins, Sam Harris, Christopher Hitchens. And I wanted to know if you think that that's the case, if you think that secularism in America picked up at that time.
It definitely became more popularized. And there's one book that a lot of people overlook, and it's called Atheist Universe. That was one of the first as well, and it was one of the most popular when it first came out. It's by a guy named David Mills, and we're fortunate enough to have it on Atheist Audiobooks as well, at atheistaudiobooks.com. But it's that whole line of thinking, it really exploded into more, I guess, the mainstream, I think. So I don't think that it helped with, I mean, it definitely helped with secularism. I don't think that's where secularism started. I think and if you go back and read older books like Our Constitution or David Niosi's Nonbeliever Nation, those books tend to go back and touch on the secular beginnings of our nation and how there've always been secular politicians. There's always been a strong fight for that and a strong fight against creationism and things like that. But you know, with new media, with publishing, with the internet, with those books coming out, with Harris and Dennett and Dawkins and Hitchens and David Mills, when those books hit the mainstream, it definitely catapulted secular thought into mainstream society for sure.
So it opened the door. Now when I was in college a million years ago, we used to have books for the blind. And you know, I was a reader because I knew computers. I would read computer books, that kind of stuff. Nowadays, with our long commutes, with the you know, I spend an hour every day in each direction from going and coming from work. Audiobooks have become very popular. It's certainly for me. They save me from killing a lot of people on the road, from road rage. But when did it occur to you that it'd be a good idea to do these audiobooks and that someone would want to listen to them, and you've concentrated on this niche basically of atheist books?
You know, funny enough, I was working full-time, and I had an hour and a half commute one way, or about an hour and 20 minutes one way to work, and I was in school. I was doing school online for psychology, and so I wanted to read my textbooks on the way home, but I couldn't. So I kept thinking, you know, it would be really cool if colleges offered textbooks in audio format. Like, that would be really cool because a lot of working adults want to, you know, do their homework, or at least, you know, if I've got four chapters to read before I take a test when I get home, it'd be nice to spend that hour and 20 minutes on the way home learning something about the test I'm going to have to take. And so that's where the first idea started. Then I thought, you know what, I, you know, textbooks are updated almost every year, so I don't know that would work. So I looked into it, started to work on it, and I thought, that's just not something that's gonna work out. Meanwhile, I was doing Dogma Debate, the radio show, so I had all the equipment, I had all the high professional studio equipment. I'm like, why not take these books that have been out that are in secular in nature and put them in audio format so people can enjoy them? And the first book I did was mine. And the funny thing about this is it was so difficult to get the formats just right, the recording just right, all the editing just right. It took me about 2 weeks to do the first book, and all I did was focus on that. When I finished it, I was sitting right here in this seat. I finished it, I stepped away from this desk, and I said, I will never do this again.
That's called spitting into the wind.
Right, it was so difficult, but I was like, I'll never do another one. And now we just actually finished we just published our 20th book, and we partnered with Audible and iTunes to release the books, and we've got three books in production right now, including a Vic Stenger title, God, the Failed Hypothesis, and we're so excited about it. It's been a huge success.
I think technology helps a lot, you know, because this wasn't possible without the internet. Now there are people in other countries that can download this and listen to these audiobooks, and I noticed that you have a couple of authors more than a couple of authors that are read their own books, and sometimes it's good to listen to the author themselves because they know what's important and they make that emphasis for those things. So I think it's a great idea. Is this something that you're planning to continue expanding, maybe to other languages or Espanol, tal vez?
Absolutely, absolutely. And I know I've talked with you a couple of times. I'm really interested in it.
I'm baiting you. That's why I'm doing.
Yeah, no, we absolutely want to do that. As a matter of fact, Brandy told me today. She's like, I think I'm waiting on some information from David Tamayo about that. So I think you're the one holding that up, guy. Come on.
I brought it up at the conference in Puerto Rico, and there are a lot of people interested. So I we need to make sure people that can module. Not everyone can, read and.
Can you just quit slacking?
Yes.
So David, do you think that the atheist media and publishing has been at its peak for the last 5 years, or do you think it's up and down, or do you think it's growing more than you thought?
It's growing to the point, which is a good thing, I think, of almost oversaturation. It used to be that you would go to the atheist section of Amazon and there were five or six books. And now there are literally hundreds and hundreds. Philosophy and atheism are sort of gathering their own category, and I believe atheism has its own category now within Amazon, and there are hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of books within atheism. So it's definitely been on the incline for quite some time, but it's by no means hit its peak. I think it's going to continue to grow to the point that we make ourselves obsolete. And I know that sounds crazy, but that's really the point of our entire movement, is to work ourselves out of a movement, is to make it so that we're no longer necessary. And then the focus will go to science education, human rights, equality, child trafficking, prison reform. We've got a lot of things as humanists that we want to be activists about, but the specific atheism category is something that hopefully we will work ourselves out of needing.
Well, I'm kind of selfish, so I'm going to take a deviation a little bit into something more personal. In Salt Lake City, when the American Atheist Convention was taking place there, you were doing your dogma debate show from there. Mm-hmm. And one of the things that sort of amazed me and amazed a lot of people, especially the security in the building, was that you went outside to the protesters, approached them and say, hey, you got something to say, I have a forum, I have microphones, why don't you come over? And if I remember correctly, you kind of had to fight with the hotel in order for this individual to be able to come in. I think he had to leave his giant cross outside. But did he bring it in? I can't remember.
Yeah, that was his caveat. He said, I'll come in if I get to bring my cross.
Oh, yeah.
And about two or three atheists helped him carry his cross into the hotel, actually.
Well, so my question is that you were amazing when it came to the Socratic method. You started asking him some questions and you guided him and guided him until he bumped into a wall that he, of his own making. So how long have you been doing this? What talent does it take to be able to do this to the Christians or to the religious people in order for them to realize that the stuff that they're talking about makes no sense?
You know, I was doing it before I realized there was a name for it. I saw so many atheists hitting a brick wall. And what they would do is they would show up and have a discussion with a Christian. The Christian is talking about their personal relationship with God, a traumatic experience that they had, something that they prayed for. These are all emotional things that are very, very important to the believer. And the atheist shows up and goes, no, you delusional idiot, evolution, science, facts, space. And you're just butting heads because ultimately the atheist is coming to an emotional discussion with scientific facts. And then the atheist gets frustrated because the Christian isn't dropping all of their emotion to pay attention to facts. And so rather than beat my argument into someone else's head, I found it was much more effective to ask a series of questions and to say things like, how do you feel about God allowing this to happen? And then they would answer me. And then I would ask them another question. And they would answer me. Then I would say, well, how do you reconcile those two things? How do you reconcile a God who is loving versus a God who watches you suffer and does nothing? And it's not really intentionally trapping them. It's that, honestly, most people don't know what they believe until they hear themselves say it. And when they have to hear themselves say it for the first time, they really start to think about their position for the first time. And I've had, and trust me, I see so many atheists, they'll hear a ridiculous answer and they pounce on that person. For example, I was at a debate just the other day, and where I had a debate against a guy with a PhD on the problem of evil. And we debated, and at the end of the debate, we were at dinner, and this Christian came up to me and started telling me about how Christianity's true, the Bible's true. So I just started asking questions. I said, is there something in the Bible that you're uncomfortable with? And he said, well, slavery bothers me a little. And I said, okay, it bothers me that it only bothers you a little, but let me ask you this. What would you do if you were God in that situation? Would you have ordered that all slaves be freed? He said, of course. And I said, well, would you have put in a commandment, thou shalt not own other human beings as property? He said, of course. And I said, then why would you worship a God that didn't do those things? And his answer was, well, if you think about it, the slaves would have never heard the gospel if they weren't captured as slaves. And he tried to justify slavery based on the slaves learning about God. And everything in me wanted to jump all over him and say, are you insane? Are you out of your mind? But I held that in and I said, do you understand how that could be offensive to some people? And he said, yeah, I do. And I said, well, how do you reconcile God going through all of those things to make that happen? How do you reconcile all that suffering just for them to learn the message when I've learned the message without ever being owned as property? And I just continued to ask questions. I didn't get angry at him. He ended up leaving. We parted ways. A couple of weeks later, Shelley Siegel comes to Dallas on tour. Mm-hmm. That Christian showed up at her concert, found her and said, is David Smalley here? I have some questions for him. I've been thinking a lot about our conversation. She comes to studio the next day and tells everybody, there's a Christian looking for you because he has more questions. We want to be a safe place for when they do start to doubt their beliefs. We want to be a safe place to explain humanism. And if we're yelling at them, if we're screaming at them, if we're calling them delusional, if we're making fun of them, if we're making them feel horrible about the way they believe, they're going to have their walls up. They're going to be defensive, and they're sure not going to come to us when they actually have legitimate questions. So the reason I ask those types of questions, I find it very, very efficient and helpful and necessary that those people actually are listening to themselves talk about these things for the first time, and they're forced to sort of connect these two things. They're forced to justify X with Y, and they've never had to do that before. And I found out later that's actually called a Socratic method because of Socrates. And then I looked it up and got a little better at it because I understood the science behind it. I honestly just think it's the most effective way to have those types of conversations.
Now, you agree that the smooth voice also helps, doesn't it?
It does.
You got that non-threatening voice. Some of us, open our mouth and now somebody wants to punch us. So I think that helps.
He has a beautiful voice for radio, I think.
Well, his face is not. His face is also bad for radio.
Well,
it's good for TV.
Let's not give him too much credit. Because I do want to ask him really quick. You've been interviewing religious people and non-religious people for quite a while now. And I wanted to know what your most memorable, positive memory is and the worst.
The worst, I think, was a guy who I didn't know was drinking on the other end of the line. And as the interview went on, he continued to drink more and more and more. And it got so bad that he was slurring his words and not making any sense at all. And I had to stop the interview live on radio because he was just flat out too intoxicated. And when I told him what we were doing, and I had to tell him live on air that we're just going to stop the interview, clearly you're intoxicated. And he got really offended, he got really angry, and then the feedback from the listeners was pretty split down the middle. Some said you should have let him continue to make an ass of himself, and the others said, there's nothing you could have done about that. You did the most respectful thing. That was probably the worst. I think the best experience was a Christian apologist who kept writing into the show. He never called, but he kept emailing, writing, he was texting, he was live tweeting, he was very interactive, but he didn't want his voice heard on our show. And he continued to argue, he was very upfront, very nasty at first, and within about 5 months, he sent me a message on Facebook with a link to his Facebook profile. And I clicked on it, and I'm looking around at his Facebook profile, I'm like, yeah, Bill, I know who you are, I know, what's your point? He's like, just keep looking. And I look over, and under religion, it said atheist.
And we started talking, and basically he said that, you know, he had a lot of questions. We answered his questions. We pointed him in the right directions, and through a few months of research, he ended up losing his faith and is now a humanist. He's an active blogger in the secular community. So.
Wow.
Oh, fantastic. That's awesome. I've had similar experiences, but not nearly as intense as that. That's really, really good.
I mean, I think it makes you feel that all the work and all those late nights and all those headaches in putting things together and all of that, you know, that's sort of the payoff. You know, you see someone, you change somebody's life for the better into a more realistic world. I think it's fantastic.
But, you know, most of the time, the Christians that I talk to, we can have positive experiences. I think the most impactful thing we do on the Christian side is not convert them or deconvert them out of their religion. It's helping them understand secular people. It's helping them understand atheists for sort of this coexistence mindset of, you know, I know Christians now that I talk to that used to hate atheists, and after coming on the show, they now defend atheists to other Christians. When Christians will say, yeah, but those atheists have no morality. Christians who've been on the show will say, now hold on a minute. I know about 15 atheists now that are really good people that are my friends on Facebook, and we just disagree on some pretty fundamental worldviews. That's, I think, is the most impactful. Every now and then we have an actual deconversion that we like to celebrate. But on the other end of the spectrum, probably the most emotional thing that's ever happened is we receive emails quite often of atheists who were abused in Christian households, who have a lot of animosity and anger, were maybe on the brink of suicide or on the brink of homicide-suicide because of the religious abuse, and ended up realizing, I don't have to be angry at my parents. I don't have to be angry at the people who forced me into the religion. They thought they were doing the best for me, and now I know better. So we've, you know, been fortunate enough to receive some very touching emails from people who were on the brink of, you know, total destruction and depression. And because they listened to our show, they felt like they had family. They felt like they weren't alone. They felt like they had a connection. And I know that can be very therapeutic for a lot of people. So receiving feedback like that from listeners, that's the true payoff for us.
Excellent.
Speaking of that, just kind of along the same line, some people are atheists and secular without being able to be open about it, right? Mm-hmm. They live maybe double lives, or we know, like through the Clergy Project, we know there's some clergy that are actually atheists but still preaching because it's the only work they know. As well as what you're talking about, you know, making atheists more personable and things like that, there's a project from the Richard Dawkins Foundation called Openly Secular that's designed to do just that, try to make being openly atheist or openly secular something that people can do. And my question is, why have you seemed to involve your family so much in your work? Because most people wouldn't be able to do something like that. You know, most people have to keep things very separate, or if they do have family, they keep it out of it. So I'm wondering why you do.
You know, it's because I really strongly believe in what I do, and I really feel like we're making a difference. I can't tell you how many people, especially Christians in my family, have said, yeah, well, you can't change the world. And I just say, hide and watch me, because I'm going to. Even if it's only three listeners at a time, I'm going to change the world. And, you know, we've seen it happen. I've actually gone with the Secular Coalition for America to Lobby Day in D.C., and I took my daughter with me. My daughter walked with me into Ted Cruz's office. My daughter walked with me on Capitol Hill and met the administrator of NASA, Charles Bolden, who sat and talked with her and then mailed us an autographed picture of himself in his astronaut uniform. I mean, you know, involving my family in things that we're doing, I think, is going to continue the process, because this is far bigger than me. This is far bigger than you or any one individual. And I want this to continue long after I'm gone. And with my children and my wife seeing what we're doing and making an impact, everybody can be involved, everybody can play a part, and when I'm gone, this thing can keep going.
Excellent.
One quick follow-up. When are you going to do an openly secular video?
I've done one, I think, at a conference a long time ago.
I want you to do another one, but like...
I will do another one.
Whole family.
Put him on the spot now.
Oh, that'd be awesome. I'd love to.
Yeah, let's do a family video.
Okay.
Everyone knows you're open about it, but let's, you know what I mean? Let's do that.
Yeah, I'd love to.
So let me ask you a question. You probably don't know how many conferences you've ever attended. You're very popular. You've been to many, many conferences and small conferences, not just the big ones. It seems, I've heard some people say that the secular community, it's oversaturated with too many conferences all over the place. And that, you know, they are expensive, they cost a lot of money, it's, you know, people go there, they are very excited for, you know, a month after, and then it wanes out. What are your thoughts about that? Do you think we have too many, just right, not enough? What are your thoughts?
David, every single conference I go to, someone comes up and says, this is the first atheist event I've ever been to. They will say, this is the first time I've been able to get out, or they finally had one close to my house that I could afford to go to. So as far as I'm concerned, we'll never have too many. I understand, for me, every time I go, it feels like a family reunion. It's a lot of the same speakers. I get to see Matt and JT and Greta and Nate Phelps and you know, all of our friends. I hang out with people that I've grown to come very close to, because, like, just like family. I mean, I love these people. For me, it's awesome. But if you're traveling around as just a participant, I can see it getting a little redundant. But that's not what's happening. And the reason these are popping up all over the place is because people want to go to ApostaCon, but they either can't afford to travel or they can't afford the hotel, so they don't go. And then they can't go to American Atheist. But then this one little conference pops up in, you know, in rural North Carolina, and everybody goes, oh my God, it's 9 miles from my house. I have to go to this. And so if you're thinking of doing a conference out there and you think nobody's going to care, do it. Just plan small, make it for 100 attendees, something small. You are making a difference, because there are people who want to connect with other secular people. They just can't get out to the bigger conferences. So I've never been to a conference where someone didn't say, this was my first atheist event, and now I really want to be involved.
So you know that Reason Rally is coming to DC, and part of it's going to be letting politicians know that the nuns are a significant group that actually vote. So I wanted to know from you, will you be attending? And if so, who you'd be voting for? No, I'm kidding. Don't answer that one. But are you going to be going? And if so, do you think Dogma Debate's going to be there doing anything for it?
You know, as soon as Sarah Moorhead took the reins on that whole thing, she called me and said, I don't know what we're going to do, but are you interested in being involved? And I said, absolutely. You tell me what you want me to do. And so I know I'll be involved in some way. The plans are still coming together. I don't know if we're doing a live show. I don't know if I'm talking. I don't know if I'm just going to be helping behind the scenes, running and get everybody water. But whatever it takes, I'll definitely be there helping.
I think you should do all that. A live show, I think, at least for one of the days. No, really. I mean, a live show for one of the days might be really, really fun, especially depending on who we can get there to be there.
I was lucky enough to be put vice president of Reason Rally.
Oh.
Yeah.
Congratulations.
So there is going to be a day where they're going to be doing media and teaching people, you know, how to have a show like this in their local area, how to do podcasts and, you know, how to communicate better with others using the available technology. So there's going to be a lot of activities and a lot of things going on that I think is going to be the biggest thing ever done. And well, I better not say more because I get in trouble. They did force me to sign non-disclosure agreement, so. Question for you. So, My Week in Atheism was a film where I am the main star in that film. I believe I am there for a whole 10 seconds, but that makes the entire film just great. So, that film, I want to know a little bit more about it. If you could go back, would you do it again? I know there's a lot of work, a lot of effort. You made a great relationship with John Christie, who's a religious fellow, and you went to a lot of religious places to show this film, which I think might have given a better impression of atheism, like you said before, to the religious part. What are some of the things you would change, or some of the things you would do differently in a documentary film of the same kind?
You know, I won an argument with John that I wish I would have lost. There was early on, he told me how long he wanted the film to be. He wanted it to be very, very short, and I was pushing for it to be longer because I'm all about more content. Anybody who listens to Dogma Debate knows I love long shows. My shows are you know, sometimes 4 or 5 hours long. But I ended up winning the argument. The film was longer than we originally planned for it to be, and I wish it would have been shorter. There's a lot of stuff I would want to cut out just because it's a little repetitive. Other than that, I think John, as the director of the film, did a fantastic job. And going into this, and look, this is so many times I hear people say, I don't want to debate, I don't want to talk with Christians, I don't want to have the argument because it doesn't matter, you're not going to change their mind. Well, first of all, yes, you can. And second of all, if you're debating with someone only because you want to change their mind, you're debating for the wrong reasons. I like to do things like this in front of public, in front of radio or television or, you know, our member cams or whatever, or in this film, because it helps other people. It helps them talk to their family members. It helps Christians talk with other atheists. And ultimately, that's what I wanted out of this deal, is for people to progress in dialogue and to continue to have those conversations and not be afraid of those conversations. And that's what happened. I mean, the film was a success in that respect. Even while we were filming, we would have an atheist group and a Christian group come together to host us at an event while we were filming. And after our filming session, nobody's seen it yet except the people who were there. The leader of the Christian group and the leader of the Secular Student Alliance went out to dinner and started talking about how they could plan events together and plan debates together. And they continued that conversation. What we don't want is the fingers in the ears, I'm right, you're wrong, you're bad, I'm good, let's blow each other up. We want to avoid that type of stuff. So ultimately, my goal was not to change John's mind. My goal was to connect with a Christian audience and let them understand atheists in a way that they had never seen atheists before. And if I had made a film by myself called, you know, Looking Into Atheism, Christians aren't going to watch that. But if it's a Christian filmmaker who says, I'm going to go live as an atheist for a week, or I'm going to dip into atheism, you can come watch me. It's okay. We'll come out together still as Christians. I think that's a lot more effective. And so the film has done quite well, I think.
Well, that's awesome. I mean, I have my own particular views about it, but we'll keep that into offline, and maybe we can talk about it at a PostCon.
Sure.
But you've been doing this for a really long time. Probably, you know, what, 30, 40 years? Something like that, because you're that old? No, of course not. You've been doing it for a while, though. You've been doing it for some time. And
it has been a while, yeah.
Yeah, and I wanted you to kind of get out your skeptic crystal ball and tell me where you think secularism in America is going and what approach you think we should be taking. I know you've touched on it a little bit, but I think I want to get a fuller answer as what different approaches we can take to continue the growth.
I don't need a crystal ball. I have Jesus dust here.
Ooh,
oh, dust. My goodness.
Actually says Jesus dust, and I had a listener make this for me and send it to me because I kept using the term on the show.
But how do you know it's Jesus and not Jesus? Might be some Mexican guy.
You just blew my mind. Maybe this is a fake. No, so you're wanting to know what I think the future of the secular movement is?
Yes, that and what approaches you think we should are most effective and the ones we should take.
Best approaches for moving forward.
You know, I like the way you worded that question. Stephanie, you're very good at this job. I want to tell you that.
We'll give her a raise.
The way you worded that question is so important, because usually when people ask me something along those lines, they say, how should we talk to people? Well, there is no right or wrong answer. But the way you worded it, which approach is the most effective? Now look, the firebrand in-your-face atheism has its place. There are people who need that. There are people who need to hear that shock and awe. I totally get that. But I think that a more diplomatic, olive branch type approach, asking questions, a Socratic method, letting them hear themselves talk, is the most effective across the board on a percentage basis. Meaning, if we put 100 Christians in the room, they heard from a firebrand and they heard from one who takes an approach similar to mine, I think more people would be affected by a softer approach. And that doesn't make me someone who is, too soft or too easy on religion. I definitely draw the hard lines. I won't take any crap on the show. I call people out. But I think that for a wide audience, a wide majority of people, the most effective is going to be a diplomatic Socratic approach.
I would call you a diplomatic firebrand, specifically for the reasons that you said. It's just been my experience that most people who we would call, say, diplomats, don't necessarily draw the hard lines where they should, whereas you're like, no, this is wrong. Like, we can have a discussion, but there are facts, and those facts aren't going to be negotiated.
Yeah. No, I think that you have that firebrand in you. You just say with a lot of ease and respect. I think that what comes across is that you respect your approach. Usually, what I hear is, the atheist is listening to me, and sometimes they're glad that you're listening. You're not just shutting them down and screaming and all of that. So I agree, there are different approaches that, and I think they all have a place at the table, and all of them combined hopefully will make this a more secular nation, more reality-based nation, rather than reality TV nation, which is worse.
Yeah, well, I'll tell you, in 3.5 years of doing the radio show, I've only had to hang up on one person. And it wasn't because he was too strong of a Christian. It's because he wasn't answering my questions. And it really bothered me because I'm trying to do a radio show. So if you want to offend me, you can tell me I'm wrong all day. But if you just refuse to answer my questions and start screwing up my radio show, that'll get you hung up on. Not being a fundamentalist Christian, for sure.
So I have a question that as I listen to you, I can't get through my head why you're not doing something that you should be doing. With your demeanor and the way you are, and the gap of language that you have, why aren't you running for office? We need more people in office. You certainly can relate to people from many aspects. Why aren't you a politician?
I'd vote for a Smalley presidency.
Smalley for president.
Absolutely, 2016. Let's go.
Start
run.
With senator. I mean, you can. I mean,
I'm writing you in, David.
I'll tell you now. That's actually in my plans. I'm looking forward to doing something like that. Being the CEO of Secular Media Group, there are so many moving parts that we have going on. There's so many things, so much content that needs to be created. I'm also working on a second book right now. I'm incredibly busy, but the truth of the matter is I see myself getting into politics here in the next few years, maybe starting off locally, starting off something within in the state government of Texas, and continuing on. Thank you for the kind words, by the way, but that's something that's actually in my plan.
I'm glad to see that. I'm as forward-thinking as you are. I'll take that as a compliment for me.
Look, the place we need secular politicians probably most, aside from, say, Louisiana, Mississippi, Alaska, is Texas.
Absolutely.
Because Texas...
Even in the school committee there.
Right, that's what I mean. Yeah. We definitely need you, so I might move to Texas specifically to vote for you so I can make sure you get into office. And, or, I would like to be involved in helping you get some traction down there and help you get into some offices.
American Atheists recently announced they've done some strategic moves, and they moved some personnel like Amanda Kniff over here to D.C. Mm-hmm. And they're starting to concentrate more in the political part of secularism. So I think it's probably we're at that point in history where we're going to start challenging, I don't know, the half a dozen or dozen states that have illegally in their constitutions that atheists can't be part of government or hold office, obviously violating the U.S. Constitution. And so I think it's going to be some exciting times coming up, not easy times. So there's going to be a lot of work and effort and, you know, the sentimental part. Yeah. It's always involving politics, but we need to encourage more people.
I get it. Sentimental because it's money.
Exactly.
Wow, I'm good.
So would you support others or encourage others also to run for office outside Texas or not to compete with you there?
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. We need as many people as possible. I think the biggest downfall that the secular movement has had overall is that we stay silent. And why do we stay silent? Well, we don't want to get fired from our jobs. We don't want to be mistreated. Politicians want to be voted for. I think we've had secular politicians. I think between us, I mean, nobody's watching this, right?
No.
I happen to think that Barack Obama's probably an atheist, but he can't say it. He can never say that because his influence doesn't end whenever his term is over, because he's going to have to endorse whoever the Democratic nominee is. And if he's an atheist, they're not going to take that nomination seriously. So. There are a lot of people, I think, that want to make a difference and that should make a difference. And whether you're running for politics or doing web design for a company, or you're a janitor in a school, if you can safely come out, that's the best thing you can do for our movement, because so many people can't.
Yes.
So we only have a few minutes left, but I did want to ask you, in front of me I have your top 10 reasons that you're an atheist.
Which are actually 11. He can't count. You can't expect to be an atheist and be able to count.
Top 10.
No, I did that. I went back and added one later because of some discussions that we're having.
Now, you're not trying to be like Jesus where, you know, there are the 10 commandments and now he comes and says the 11th commandment is love each other and so therefore now it's 11. Or because,
well,
you know,
like the Trinity?
Yeah.
You have 3 and 1. Well, I have 11 reasons in my one reason for being an atheist.
Oh, there you go.
All right, so of those now 11, since counting's not your forte, I want to know, of those 11 reasons, which is your, not only your favorite, but the one that you feel is strongest among them. I realize they're all pretty strong, but I want to know what your strongest is.
It's number 11. It's the last one, because being genuine, being honest with yourself, flat out saying, look, I'm just being honest with the fact that I don't believe this stuff. Would you rather me walk around as a fake Christian, or would you accept me as an authentic atheist? And that really makes the Christian stop and think, can I choose my belief? Am I deciding to be a Christian? So many people start off that question saying yes. They think they can choose their belief. And then I say something like, so you can climb on top of this building, close your eyes, and believe that the building's only 3 inches tall and jump. They immediately realize they cannot choose their beliefs. You can't decide. You can choose to hope for something. You can go through the motions. You can take the casserole. You can play in the band. You can even get up and preach. But at the end of the night, if you don't really believe what you're doing is true, you can't change that. And so ultimately, as atheists, what we're doing is we're being genuine. We're being honest with the people around us and saying, I don't believe these things, and I'm being honest about it. And ultimately, I think that's the best thing you can ask for someone, is that they be genuine rather than to be a fake Christian.
Well, in your list, one of my favorites to show Christians is actually something that was written like 360 BC by Epicurus, and I'll read it just because it's very short. Is God willing to prevent evil and not able? Then he's not omnipotent. Is he able but not willing? Then he's malevolent. Is he both able and willing? Then whence cometh evil? Is he either able? Is he neither able nor willing? Then why call him God? What are some of the, and we have 30 seconds left, but what are some of the responses that you have gotten from people in the street, Christians in the street, or religious people about this?
You know, they tend to say that they don't have all the answers, but they hope all answers will be answered in the end. All questions will be answered in the end. And that's where I differ. I say that's just not good enough. And if you would do something to stop these horrific things from happening to people, but you're not powerful enough, and God is powerful enough and does nothing, I say that you have a higher morality than the God you worship. And you really need to stop and think, is this God even worth
okay.
If he does exist.
Thank you so much. And well, we run out of time as always. We will see you soon in a couple of weeks. And thank you all for watching our show today. Thank you.
Thank you.